Excellent. So you highlighted one point which resonated with me. You said that, you know, the physical and the digital is a part of life. It's not either or. So obviously now you are embracing technology to be more successful on the digital world. The technology is going to play a very important role to make you that particular sustainable business outfit where consumer behavior is more digital savvy. Millennials are more tech savvy. They are using their smart devices. Their buying pattern is mostly on the web. And also they are trying to get the same experience which you like to offer on the physical store. How do you see that technology can play a role in terms of customer interaction, engagement, which should be giving them the same look and feel or experience? You alluded some part of it, like fashion show done on the web.
Yeah.
Similarly, how you will offer me the kind of product or you know, the brand or the thing when I come to the web or when I come to the web channel, omni-channel, right? So now I'm thinking of the digital interface. Then also looking at the process automation, because you are pressed for the revenue. You are looking for profitability. How can you do more with less? Can you talk about those things, how technology can help?
So Alak, I think technology is not about only digital. So for example, if you are looking at, retail channels broadly divided between digital channels and, physical channels like store, etc. I believe that technology has a role to play in both the channels, right? So there's a lot of efficiency that technology can bring in into the brick and mortar, retail sector, especially in countries like India. I think if the kind of technology application that I've seen in US and UK, I don't think in India has still adopted it, right? Warehouse fulfillment center, the way they are, robot enabled to, process at a very high level of efficiency. I don't think, in India, we are able to do that. I think the whole buying, the buying and merchandising and planning process in India is still a lot more kind of individual driven. The whole knowledge base is residing in the mind of, one or two critical buyer or category heads. All that can be systemized, through, with the whole concept of machine learning, artificial intelligence. We know that the machines will be able to make those decisions, which are actually, humans are good at making decisions which don't have a history, which can't be molded into a formula. But if it's an algorithmic kind of a decision, and if you can codify it, especially if it's a non-linear kind of a multivariate kind of a decision, which fashion certainly is, then I think a machine will be able to do it much better, right? Mm-hmm. Probably in India, you needed the business to achieve a certain scale when the technology, technology investments, because that the upfront investment is huge, it generates, it justifies the ROI. I think, the kind of scale that, Reliance has achieved, today it will be able to justify, it will be able to make those heavy bets in technology and, justify that for people, for other retailers who are not the size of Reliance. What's happening is that I see an ecosystem developing of, many, tech companies, including Centric and some of the other guys who will be offering these services as a plug and play model to, medium sized retailers, right? Mm-hmm. And they will be able to benefit. So I think technology, AI, machine learning, etc. have a huge role to play even in brick and mortar. Mm-hmm. And, the example that I gave you is in terms of improving efficiency and, profitability, right? Mm-hmm. Markdown decisions, buying decisions, planning decisions, etc. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But the same thing, it can have a lot more experience in terms of, impact in terms of customer experience, right? What is one of the biggest source of customer disappointment in a physical store? Mm-hmm. That is, you go in, you walk, you like certain product and you realize that it's not available in your size, mm-hmm. right? Now, technology can eliminate that. One is it can minimize by optimizing the size curve for individual stores rather than the same size curve going to all the stores, etc. Mm-hmm. The second is, you can have a process where, if the customer, a much faster supply chain between the warehouse to the store. So even if it, it has run out of store and the customer wants it, probably you can get it the next day, delivered to the store, right? Based on the customer requirement, or maybe collect order in the store and deliver it to customer at his home. So mm-hmm. that will be one way of, improving customer efficiency, mm-hmm. Customer experience. The other thing is, certainly with all this corona related issues, one of the things that people are very scared of is the whole touch thing, right? Mm-hmm. Now fashion is all about touch and feel. You want to try it out, you know, you want to know whether how it fits you. So any technology which is there, which helps me kind of, you know, do a trial without touching the garment, right? You know, will, I think, you know, it can be a booster for those kind of technology. And I think, you know, I know some of the brands which have experimented with that, but have not been very, very successful. Now, when the technology integrates in the physical world, right? I think, you know, one of the ways will be that physical and the digital world, you know, at the interface of it, one of the ways the business will play is maybe the stores will become what is called the experience center, right?
Yes.
So while we are talking of, you know, lots of, you know, brick and mortar business trying to move to e-com, actually, in a way, without people kind of, you know, taking a big note of it, lots of purely digital native business, right? Especially in furniture retail, etc., or fashion retail also in India, you have seen that they have been setting up experience center in India, right? Like, you know, Urban Ladder, which is mostly sells through digital, but customers wanted to, you know, touch and feel the furniture. So they have set up a couple of experience center. You can't buy from there, but you go to, you know, get, you know, experience. Similarly, you know, direct to consumer fashion retailers, you know, like Bombay Shirt Company, or, you know, some of the other players like those, which have 100% of their business coming from, you know, the e-com space. They are setting up one or two experience center where customer can go and physically teach, you know, feel the product, try it out. And this is very, very useful, you know, at least for the first time enrollment, right? You know, kind of a customer. And once a customer becomes comfortable with it, then, you know, his subsequent purchases can happen online, right? So that's another, you know, place where technology, you know, very, you know, e-com enabled technology in a physical store can help you, you know, have the customer a seamless journey transition from a brick and mortar to a e-com or a digital world, right? The third, which is a pure e-com or, you know, pure digital, how can it enhance, you know, consumer experience? So, you know, I always am interested in stories from outside of the retail world, right? Because I think, you know, or outside of the fashion world. One of the things that I've realized is all of us are into a betting business. In fashion, you are in a betting business. You have to bet what will happen tomorrow.
Yes.
And you can't know it, right? Yeah. So you look for signals. You can look for signals from, you know, other industries. So today, you know, I think, you know, while listening to, I don't know whether a BBC podcast or, it was the BBC Global News podcast. You know, it talked about the whole disco thing. You know, a virtual disco party that was organized, right? Where, you know, people could, you know, use their own VR set and they could join in into that disco, this thing. So you can't do a high five, or you can get a virtual high five kind of thing. You can't, you know, get a drink, but apart from that, you could get an experience almost like, you know, dancing, you know, with a, you know, bunch of this thing, right? Now, we know that this VR technology has been, you know, around for, you know, quite some time, you know, VR and, you know, augmented reality. But they have not been put to use because I think the cost of, you know, putting that in place was much higher because physical was much easier. Today, when your customers want to have the same experience, but from a long distance, you can do this. Again, to give you an allied, you know, allied industry example, for example, hospital, you know, in reality business, real estate business. Today, you know, it's not possible to for people to go and have a tour of a project which is under construction, right? You know, the typical thing was you will create a show flat where a customer will go in, look at that, and then take a decision to buy the flat. Today, what you can do is you can create a virtual reality, you know, experience for the customer, right? So, you know, these are the signals that I'm picking up. And I'm sure the interesting thing is that the consumers are much smarter than us professionals. They keep flirting with each of the technology, and then they realize that given the way the environment has changed, they will, you know, adapt one technology more than the other. Our job is to keep tracking that so that we join that bandwagon, we join that inflection point, you know, with that curve at the right inflection point. If you are too early, we'll be making too much technology investment and not get return on it. If you are too late, then we will be left obsolete, right? But, you know, these are some of the examples where technology will play a role in enhancing efficiency and customer experience in physical world, interface of physical and digital, and in the pure digital world, right?
Excellent, Mridumesh. You have enlightened a lot in terms of how technology, and, you know, Centrique is one of the leading technology company out of Silicon Valley in the US, involved in robotic process automation, providing on both omni-channel support of the robotic chatbots where the customers could be engaged with that. And then also automating some processes which are mundane so that you can do more with less. And also providing AI ML-based predictive guided insights to business leaders like you. So you talked about many things in this few minutes where you're talking about augmented reality, virtual reality, which Centriq is already trying to provide that access point. So when we are talking about balancing the act, like if you are coming to the physical world, physical store, bricks and mortar, how can I get the experience of the product? Yet fulfillment should be done via web or other digital delivery or delivery at home. Now, if we are trying to provide web showrooming, the new concept here in the US, people say that, for web showrooming, meaning that means I need to first experience a product before coming out at your physical store. So you have outlined that. When I'm coming to your physical store, you're saying that I don't want to deliver here, I will deliver at home. That means you're changing the rule of game. You're saying that when I'm coming to your showroom, you're not going to give me the product. When I'm coming to the web, you're just giving me the experience, come to my store. So this is a perfect blend as it is happening. And I can see that in all the situation, your technology, which is augmented reality, the virtual reality, robotic process automation, AI, ML is playing very important role. You also talked to me earlier about dynamic pricing, because in the retail industry, this is hell of a lot. Like every time I go and see that there is 30% sale, 40% sale round the clock. How are you going to manage this? And because you're compromising on your margin of a retail bank. Now, profitability is the key. Now, Centriq is also trying to address the dynamic profitability management. You can only sell more and you can only manage your cost so that your profitability is maintained. How do you address that?
No, so, I think that's one of the critical questions, right? Which retailers have tried to answer, but, we have been able to answer that very suboptimally, which is, what is the right price? But we know that, if you price it too high, you'll lose money. And if you price it too low, you'll lose money. So there's an optimum pricing point. Some of our allied industries, for example, travel and tourism, they have found a solution in the concept of, dynamic pricing, right? So, today there is no fixed rate for a hotel. So depending upon the demand, the price goes up and down. And, it helps, those industries optimize the profit, right? Their revenues and profit. Unfortunately, in retail, we have not been able to do it. We have had a very static view of price, right? And if at all, we have tried to bring in flexibility, it has been at a very broad level, right? So, this is something that, one of my earlier bosses used to tell me that, it's a lazy way of doing, pricing, right? Mm-hmm. Which is you say that entire store 30% off. Mm. But no, you don't need to do that. But you need to get, as you said, that, giving any discount on a retail price. And we have to have a retail price because that's part of government regulations in most of the places. So you can't keep changing price. You need to have a ticket price or a retail price, etc. But then you kind of manage your dynamic pricing by offering a certain level of discount and promotion on that. Mm-hmm. Now, where do you want to give that discount? You want to give a discount if that product's actual rate of sale is lesser than what you bought it for. What is the assumption of rate of sale you made while buying? So if it's lesser than that, then you actually want to give a bit of discount, give a bit of artificial boost to the rate of sale, so that it still sells out within its life of the line. Because as we discussed earlier in fashion, the moment the product has gone beyond its life of the line, the inventory erodes in value, right? So that's one thing that you have to predict. Now, if you have got 2,000 products in your store, certainly not all the 2,000 products are, selling at the same rate of sale. So then why do you want to give 30% off an entire, across the store? So an intelligent way of doing it will be to judge every product on its merit, right? So for example, out of 3,000 products that you have in your store, probably there are 1,000 which are doing better than their, anticipated rate of, sale. Mm-hmm. So probably, you can ensure that whatever built-in discount you had, whatever discount you built into the pricing for lower rate of sale, because it's actually selling faster than that, you don't even give that discount, and you realize actually a higher margin than what was budgeted at the time of buying. There's some average, so then you give only the planned rate of discount, so maybe 10% off, 15% off, 20% off, etc. While there might be some lines which are slaying, going very, very slow, so there probably you need to have 70% off, some can have 50% off, right? So the idea is that instead of having, so that dynamic in this case may mean that of all the articles in your store, each article gets its own discount calculated basis its performance. Also, if some product is in your store over a period of, let's say, 20 weeks, which is typically a season, then in every season, the discount percentage changes depending upon its rate of performance. Now you look at it, we talked about a single variate and a linear decision making. That's what a human mind can do. But the moment you are looking at multiple variables, right? In this simplest example that I gave you, there are number of articles, and the other variable is the time scale, right? So there are already two variables. And then we know that the performance of any line is not linear. It doesn't keep selling five pieces across every week. It will sell faster in the initial when it's new, and after that the rate will slow down. So human mind cannot model that. So if you have a computer, computer generated algorithm, which is, and the beauty of it is that earlier this couldn't be solved, but we didn't had, we had only a static algorithm. We had to fix, have a kind of fixed regression equation fixed in for this thing. So, but that regression can be a single, or maybe, two or three regression equations for any brand, which still meant that out of 3,000 articles, you are still trying to group, each of them, probably 500 or 600 of them into one group. But with the, power of AI, ML, etc. Now, every, you can have a true meritocracy in fashion, right? Mm-hmm. Every article basis its performance at that point of time will get its pricing. Mm-hmm. And, we know that meritocracy is good for all. So, let's, hail to the meritocracy of fashion. Let every article earn its own price through dynamic pricing. And that's when the retailers will make money.
Absolutely. So fascinating conversation, Dimesh. You touched upon a lot many areas, and I can see you are so much entrenched into technology. And we have talked about Centric is addressing these problems. So Profit Edge is one solution is coming out based on these narratives. So you can have multivariate or algorithm based on the AI can solve these problems. And hopefully with the blend of process automation based on customer engagement, providing them the delight, not compromising on customer experience and net promoter score, we are also trying to incorporate emotional intelligence of customers. So EQ score, this is the new term we are bringing in from Centric, customer EQ score. You are familiar with NPS. How can we develop the EQ score of a customer by which you are rated? Are you listening to customer? Are you empathizing customer if you have done something not in favor of customer? So those are the areas which we are so motivated and to offer all the services to retail segment. Any closing thoughts or guidance to other retailers? Just quick 2 minutes message for them.
So, we are into the business of human emotions. Right, you talked about EQ, but basically, customer is not buying a dress, he's buying a whole philosophy, a feeling of feeling rich, feeling fashionable, feeling very trendy with this, right? And we know that if one thing we have learned about humanity is that the resilience, right? Human emotions always find a way to express itself, whatever kind of situation. So I'm sure that things will get better. Now, what will happen is that, how will humans express themselves? Will they seek joy through visiting stores? Will they seek joy through buying a new dress? Or will it be in some new ways? So we'll have to track that. We'll have to adapt to that. So that's something that, all of us should look for. As I said earlier, probably with this disruption, it's not possible to get back to 100 of the sale, but it's very, very possible to get to 110 of the profit. So that's the way we need to look at, this is an opportunity to become much more efficient, right?